Hi, my name is John Peacock, and this is my story. I was born in 1962 in Chicago, Illinois, and had a very interesting experience. My grandfather was born on the island of Sicily, just south of the main island of, or south of Italy. And Grandpa was born there in the late 1800s and migrated to the United States, to New York, and then finally settled in Chicago. But what was interesting about Grandfather's story was that Grandpa eventually, when he moved to the United States, he didn't speak much English. And it was a pretty rough go there for a while. And when he turned about, I'm not sure about his age, but he was a young man, and he was walking the streets of Chicago, and he heard some people singing in Italian. And it turned out that they were Moody Bible Institute. And that was the means by which Grandpa became a Christian. Because Grandpa had left Christianity. When he was born in Sicily, his parents had died during a plague. And it was one of the plagues that swept through Europe around that time. And the week after his parents had died, he went to the Catholic Church. And as he was sitting in the pew, the priest came up to him and said, "No, you sit in the back now. You're an orphan." And it left him with a really bad taste about God. And so it was a major thing in his life to, when he came to the United States, to actually consider God and to give God a second chance like that. And he did, and he became a Christian. And God really proved himself faithful to my grandfather. When my grandfather was a few years older, he was in his 50s, and he had been widowed, and he met another widower, which was my grandmother. She was in her late 40s. And they married, and he's in his 50s, she's in her late 40s, and Grandma got pregnant. And the baby was born, and the baby was healthy. Can you imagine that? She's in her late 40s, and she has a baby, and the baby is healthy. And so they named the baby Grace, because they felt God had given them grace. And that was my mom. And so it reminds me, it's an important lesson that always reminds me. You know, sometimes we feel in life that it's too late. You know, too many things have happened, too many things have passed by. But God is amazing. God is a master of taking things that seem too late and bringing good out of them. So my mom, when she turned about 18 years old, Grace, decided to marry my dad. She had met him earlier, and he was also 18 years old, and they got married, and at 19, mom was pregnant and had me. So I was, she was a young lady with a baby already. And mom and dad went on to have two other children, the younger sister, Lori, and then the youngest one, Geraldine. And so there were three of us in the family. And we lived pretty much in the suburbs of Chicago, out near O'Hara Airport. Dad was involved with usually two or three different jobs when we were growing up. He worked in a variety of different fields, like machinist and janitor, realtor, all kinds of different things. He was involved with landlords, was a landlord for a while. And we worked a lot. Growing up, my sisters and I would come home, and instead of playing, we would come home and we would look on the refrigerator, and there Dad would leave a list of our chores, you know, and there's nothing wrong with chores, but we spent a lot of time learning how to work hard. So I had two younger sisters, and we seemed to find a way to enjoy life. When I was younger, one of my sisters, Lori and Gerald slept in the same room together, and I slept in my room together, and Lori and Gerald had a big queen-size bed that they shared, and Lori always slept on one side of the bed, and Geraldine always slept on the other side of the bed. Well, we were always up to kind of tricks and stuff. Well, one night, I was sleeping in the middle of the night, and Lori crept into my room with her pillow, and she took her pillow out and started beating me with the pillow, just beating the daylights out of me. And then she said, you can't get me. And she ran back into her room, and when she ran back into her room, she rolled Gerald Lynn over to her side of the bed, who Gerald Lynn was sound asleep, she didn't know what was going on. She rolled Gerald Lynn over to her side of the bed, and then she got in on Gerald Lynn's side of the bed and threw the covers over both of them. Well, I knew who it was that had beat me with the pillow, so I was awake now. And I got up, took the pillow, my pillow, went into their room and just beat the heck out of Lori's side of the bed, which was sleeping Gerald Lynn. And we had a good pillow fight for a while. So Lori is obviously grew up, and she is married and living in the Chicago area. She is a VP of import-export. Her husband is also an import-export. And my sister Geraldyn is married and lives in Indiana near South Bend, where she works interior design. And her husband is a professor at Notre Dame University. They have two young men, or two boys, that they had. Gerald had two children. And they're young men now. One is Jake, and the other is Joe. And Jake is in his fourth year of college at Indiana University, and Joe is just graduated from high school. So we grew up in the Chicago area, and it was your typical suburban town. We were typical suburban kids. We didn't know a lot about anything except malls and cruising, and went to high school in the Wooddale-Bensonville area of Illinois. And after we graduated from high school, I hung around with a couple guys during high school. Their names were Rick and Glenn, and we spent a lot of time together. But then once we graduated, we went through all to different colleges. So after I graduated from high school, I went to a college that was near my home. It was called Elmhurst College, and started taking classes there. Really wanted to go into engineering, but my dad didn't want me that far away from home. So I started at this school and really met some great professors and really enjoyed what I was doing and got kind of hooked into physics and mathematics. So I did there at Elmhurst a bachelor's degree with majors in physics, a major in mathematics, and a minor in computer science. But it was there that I really kind of began my experience with God. I had been raised in a kind of Moody Bible church, or an Italian Moody Bible kind of church. It was an offshoot of Moody Bible, but it was an Italian. And then as we got older, we started to go to a Baptist church. But when I got into high school, I just kind of started to lose my desire to really hang out with God or do stuff like that. My mom used to take us to church every week. We went to church Wednesday nights. We went to church on some Friday nights. We went to church on Sundays. Sometimes she tried to get us to church on Sunday nights. And but my dad was not a very religious person. He was working, so mom would say, you can either go to church or stay home and work with your dad. And that was motivation. We went to church. So we grew up going to church, but I think when I was in high school, I just really kind of lost my interest in it. And still went because mom insisted on it. But when I got into college, I really walked away from God. I wasn't really interested in religious things. I was more interested in just the, having fun, having a good time, meeting girls, my school and stuff like that. But you know what's really amazing? When you walk away from God, God runs after you. And so my senior year in college, I was graduating, and I was blessed with a lot of, these nice things. But my senior year in college, God did something incredibly special. He said in actions, not words, but actions, he said, John, I'm going to give you everything you think will make you happy in life. So In my mind, I had a pretty good idea of what would make me happy in life. What would make me happy in life was a fancy car, living in a great place, having a beautiful girlfriend, and having lots of money. If you had those things, you would be happy in life. And I was pretty sure that that was the ticket to happiness. And so my senior year in college, God did some amazing things. First of all, I was offered a job with Hughes Aircraft Company, which is an aerospace defense company here in California. And it was not just a job, it was a corporate rotator position. It was an incredible job. It was a job I nowhere deserved. But they had offered me this position, and with that came a great salary. I was making really good money coming out of college. They even sent a semi-truck to move me out of my dorm room. I mean, the movers laughed. It was like, are you serious? And I'm like, yeah, this is all there is, just my dorm room. And they're like, wow. So I moved, and they moved me from Chicago to Southern California, which for a Midwest boy, that's like a big Disneyland. I mean, these are the places we hear about, we watch in the movies. I mean, it's Hollywood and Beverly Hills, and I was running around Rodeo Drive and going out to the island, Catalina Island, and up to Malibu, and all these places I had always heard about. So I had the beautiful, where I was living in a beautiful place, Southern California. I had the good salary. And my senior year, I also won the heart of a young lady that was the homecoming queen for her high school. She was beautiful, she was smart, and she was funny. Her name was Aileen, and we started dating, which was amazing to me. And the last thing that I really kind of had in my heart that was the perfect life was to have a great car. And so when I graduated from college, I bought a brand new convertible Jeep, complete with the roll bar and the saddlebags, and you could take the top off and take the doors off. You could take the windshield off if you wanted to eat bugs. I mean, it was just a great, great, great car. So I had everything that was supposed to make you happy in life. I've got this beautiful girl. I'm running around in this convertible. I'm driving around, you know, down by the beach, and I'm living in Southern California, and I'm making a great salary. So when I went to work for Hughes is a big aerospace defense firm down in Southern California, and I started in their radar systems, which was down in El Segundo, and then I rotated out to ground systems. They made systems to help the Army in the field, and eventually ended up at what's called the Missile Systems Division out in Canoga Park. The Missile Systems Division, I worked in what was called their laboratory, and they were kind of the advanced system that did machine vision. They were teaching basically computers and missiles how to see. And so they would teach them how to identify things with digital image processing. So the job was great, and I really enjoyed it. But something was unfolding in my life. I wasn't really particularly interested in God. I didn't really have a desire for religion. I was happy just kind of running around doing the things that made life happy to me. But there was something that was unfolding in my life in the sense that I realized, how come you have everything that you want and you really don't feel happy deep inside? And it kind of shook me up a little bit. It made me begin to think, you know, you have money, you live in a great place, you have a beautiful girlfriend, and you drive a beautiful car and you're not happy. And what even shook me more was Aileen and I began to have fights. And when I was growing up, there was something, my parents always fought. And I hated that. I just hated the way my parents treated each other. And if there was anything I didn't want, it was I didn't want a relationship like my mom and dad had. And here I had everything I wanted, and Aileen and I are fighting, and we're sounding like my mom and dad. And I remember one point, it just shook me so much. I walked into the bathroom, Aileen and I had been fighting about something. I walked into the bathroom, locked the door, and began to cry. And I couldn't even explain why. Maybe it was just the sense that, how could this be happening? How could you have all of these things that were supposed to make you happy, and yet you're not? So while I was working for Hughes had a great program. They said, if you want to go to school, we will pay for you to go to graduate school while you work for us. So I wanted to get in a physics program, and one of the places that you could do physics Southern California area was University of California, Riverside. They had a high energy physics program. And so I enrolled in the program, started taking classes, and there I met this guy. And his name was Teddy. And Teddy was just unique. He was something else. Just a reminder, I grew up in the Midwest, and we've heard of vegetarians, but I don't think I knew of one. And so when I first met Teddy, I told him, I said, hey, come on, I'll take you out, I'll buy you lunch. And he's like, I'm a vegetarian. And I'm like, okay, I've heard of you guys. I don't quite know what you eat, but I know there are some restaurants that deal with people like you. And so I said, well, I'll take you to a salad bar. And Teddy said, I don't eat salads. I'm like, what do you eat? You don't eat meat, you don't eat salads, what do you eat? He said, I eat grillers. And I'm like, what is a griller? Well, Teddy, a griller was one of these artificial hamburgers or whatever. But Teddy and I began spending a lot of time together because we were both in this high energy physics program, and we were both over our heads. This program was incredible. We were way over our heads. And so we would go to these classes, and we would sit in these classes, and we would come on these classes, and we were like, do you have any clue what that man was talking about? And we generally did not. So we would run to the library, and we would spend all this time trying to solve our homework, hoping that somebody else in the world had to put up with what we were going through, and wrote it down in a book somewhere. Well, sometimes late at night, when Teddy and I were just so full of physics we couldn't talk anymore, Teddy would bring up the concept of God. And I wasn't particularly interested in God, but the things that Teddy said about God really kind of left me feeling like, that makes sense. God makes sense. Up to that point, God had not made sense to me in my life. I mean, I knew that you were supposed to like God, you're supposed to love God or else. And there were a lot of nice people in the churches that I went to, but it didn't make sense. You might as well hang your brain with your hat at the door. Religion was, when I look back on a religion, most of my religion was motivated out of guilt and fear. You don't want to go to the hot place, do you? There was no love, deep love. It was just, you better or else. Well, as I would walk away from these conversations with Teddy, it was just making sense to me, a little more logical. Well, as time went on, things just got worse and worse in my life. You know, school wasn't going well, work wasn't going well, Aileen and I were fighting, and I just finally got to a place where I decided, you know what, I'm done. And so I left my job, I left graduate school, I broke up with Aileen, and I decided that I was going to go back to school full time. I was going to try to work and go to school. I was going to go back to full time school, and it was going to be in something that was not high energy physics. So I went into a program called Applied Physics up in Oregon. I was accepted up there. But before I left, I decided I'd go and say goodbye to Teddy, because Teddy lived not too far from me. Well, I went out to say goodbye to him. And as I was saying goodbye to him, and Teddy was such a good friend, he was just always a loving guy. And when I was saying goodbye to him, there were tears in his eyes. And he said, "Buddy, I'm going to miss you." Well, I was way too macho to cry then. I was just like, "Yeah, and I'm going to miss you too." But I realized something. I was leaving probably one of the best friends I had ever had in my life. The guy was just a good person. Well, that day that I had visited Teddy, Teddy had actually asked me, he said, "Hey, can you help me? I need to move a woman I know, a friend of ours." Teddy was married, and so this was another friend of theirs. And he said, "Can you help me move this lady?" And I said, "Sure." So we went over and we started moving this lady. Well, she was cute. And I was interested, but I was also careful. You see, Teddy had, through the months and years that I had known him, he had tried to share stuff with me. He would try to give me Bible studies. He would try to give me books. He would invite me to church. And I just put the books on the shelf and didn't really read the Bible studies and just didn't go to church. Well, when I met this girl, Teddy capitalized on the moment. He said, "You know, something like, I don't remember, why don't you come to church? She'll be there." Somehow I found out she was going to be there. And so I was hesitating, but I really wanted to get to know this girl. And because I was hesitating because it was very bizarre to me to go to church on Saturday. All my life, everybody I knew went to church on Sunday. And I had never, ever heard of a Seventh-day Adventist before. At that point in my life, even if you would have gone back to Chicago at that point, to get the closest Adventist church was 45 minutes away. Never heard of an Adventist. In my mind, Adventists were synonymous with Hare Krishna. They were this strange California religion that didn't eat meat or drink coffee and went to church on Saturday. And so I was very apprehensive to go to their church, but I really wanted to meet this girl. And so I went to the church that morning on a Saturday morning, so weird, went to the church, pulled in, sat down in the pews, Teddy was there, and as I sat in the pew, they began to sing hymns. And they sang the same hymns that I sang in my Baptist church, hymns that were familiar to me. And I began to just kind of relax and, you know, just enjoy the service. And of course, Marlene, that was the name of the girl that I was interested in, Marlene was there too. And so everything was cool until it was time for the elders to come out. So the door opens at the front of the church and out come the elders to get on the platform. But the pastor is dressed like the high priest in the Old Testament. It was so weird. I mean, the whole long white garment with the bells and the pomegranates at the bottom, the breastplate with the jewels in it, the jewels on the shoulder, the funny looking hat with the gold plate on it. I mean, the whole thing. And on top of that, I was looking around the church and there were furniture that I had never seen before, like a golden candelabra and a altar, like altar where they sacrifice things, the kind of altar. And I was just freaking out. And it was at that very moment, I was sitting next to Teddy, that the Holy Spirit worked in just the perfect way. Because Teddy reached over and he whispered in my ear, as all this fear and panic of what kind of weird religion this is, all this fear and panic that's in me, Teddy reached over and he whispered in my ear and he said, "Yeah, and we have a heathen sacrifice halfway through the service." And I laughed, and I looked at him, and I whispered back, and I said, "I repent." I only knew of one heathen in the whole place, and that was me, and I didn't want to be their sacrifice that day. But Teddy was so good, he went on to explain, and he said, "No," he says, "you know, the pastor's dressed like that." It turned out the pastor is his dad. But the pastor was dressed like that because he was doing a series on the Old Testament. And specifically the sanctuary in the Old Testament. He was explaining what the garments of the high priest represented. And so he addressed life that way to show people and to help them understand why, you know, they wore what they did wear. Well, that was my first time in an Adventist church, and I went home, had lunch, I believe, with that young lady and Teddy and his wife. And then I moved because, like I said, I kind of quit everything. And I moved up to Oregon to go back to school full time. And I started in a applied physics program up in Oregon. So through the week, I would go to school, and all week long, we would study the laws of physics. And I mean, there are a lot of laws in physics. We study the laws of gravity, the laws of thermodynamics, the laws of electromagnetics, the laws of quantum physics, the laws, the laws, the laws. But then on the weekends, I would go to this church. I knew it. The reason I should back up a little bit, the reason I even went to this church was because I was interested in that girl, and I knew that Christians and non-Christians should not get together. When Christians and non-Christians get together and they have relationships, it usually ends up to people hurting. And I never wanted that. And so I thought, well, I need to find out for myself if there is a God. It's not fair to this girl for me to be in this relationship and not be a Christian. So either we break the relationship or I got to figure out what's going on. So when I moved up to Oregon, I decided that I would check out a church, an Adventist church. So I looked in the Yellow Pages, flipped through, and I found the one that was not too far away. Got in the Jeep, drove over, and walked into this church. It was a beautiful church. And I walked into the church, and this little old lady met me at the door, and she says, "Won't you come and sign our guest book?" Well, I didn't want to sign the guest book. That was the last thing I wanted to do, because in the Baptist church, when you sign the guest book, that means you're going to get a visit from the pastor, and I didn't want to see the pastor. So I was trying to get out of it, but she was so sweet, and I was like, "Oh, just give me the book," and I signed it. Well, I went in, I sat down, they started singing those familiar hymns again, and out came the elders again, and thankfully they were all dressed normally. But then the pastor got up and he said, "Today is communion." Now, I think my second or third time in an Adventist church. He says, "Today is communion." I was like, okay. I've been through communion in the Baptist church. But then he said, "And all us guys are going to go down in the basement and wash each other's feet." And I'm like, this is such a weird religion. This is so bizarre. Why are people going to go down in the basement? I'm not going down in the basement to wash somebody else, a bunch of guys' feet. I have no idea what's going on downstairs in those basements. And so, but the pastor was good enough. He said, "You know, you can just wait here and listen to the children's story or relax." So I waited there, and then I went home, and I called Teddy, and I'm like, "Man, your church is so weird. I mean, what's all this with feet washing?" And he's like, "Bozo, don't you remember when Jesus washed the feet of the disciples in the Bible?" I'm like, "Yeah, but I never heard anybody doing that in real life." Well, we're real biblically oriented. Something began to unfold, because I started going to church on a regular basis, and I started at the same time, I was going to school, and through school we were studying the laws of physics over and over again, and then when I walk into church, we would study the laws of God. And I began to wonder, did the same guy that wrote the laws of the universe write the moral laws? And I knew enough about physics that I knew that gravity was necessary for life. The Earth is spinning at the equator nearly 1,000 miles per hour. And if you were on a merry-go-round spinning at 1,000 miles per hour, and all of a sudden you didn't hang on, you'd go flying off. So if it wasn't for gravity, you know, the human race would become human projectiles and fly off into space. So gravity is necessary for life. But I also knew that if I walked up to the edge of a cliff and stepped off the edge of that cliff, the same laws of gravity that were meant to provide, you know, health and life to humanity would start plummeting me to my destruction. That same law that was necessary for human life would start destroying me. Well, I began to wonder, could it be the same with the moral law? Could the moral law act in a similar way? Let's say that I come over to your house and you've got a bunch of DVDs sitting out on your table. And while we're talking, I look and you've got so many, and I think to myself, you know, this guy, he's got so many DVDs, he is not going to miss one. And so while you're out of the room, I take one of those DVDs and I stuff it into my pocket and take it and steal it. Now let's say the next day I'm at my house, the DVD is sitting out on the table, and somebody else comes over to visit me. And then my phone rings and I step out of the room to answer it. What thought is going to force itself on my attention? And the thought will be something like this. Will that person do to me what I did to you yesterday? Will they steal that DVD just like I had stolen it? It's a thought that probably never came in my mind before, but in essence, there was a whole new level of anxiety and suspicion that had never been there before. You see, I stepped off the edge of a moral cliff. Not a physical cliff where gravity is sucking me down, but a moral cliff where worry and anxiety are destroying me. And God was beginning to reveal himself to me in a way that was very tangible. You know, all my life I've been growing up, my mom would say stuff like, read the Bible, and I would be like, in my little boy's brain, why would I want to do that? That's boring. People would say, you ought to believe in God, it's good for you, stuff like that. And I knew what I was supposed to do. But this was different. It was different because it wasn't what I was supposed to do. It was something that made sense. It was something that was logical. God was logical. God was reasoning with me in the way I could be reached. He was approaching me in a way that I could relate to him. And as I saw this, you know, as God was unfolding things to me, as he was teaching me himself, I began to realize that God was making more and more sense. Well, I continued to go to church, and eventually that pastor showed up. Praise God, he didn't show up right away. But eventually he showed up and he said, are you interested in Bible studies? And I started doing Bible studies. And really sweet couple, Brett and Gail Stevens, started giving me Bible studies. And we would go through stories in the Bible that I knew from a kid, but also bugged me. Stories like, why did God harden Pharaoh's heart and then destroy him? That didn't seem fair. And we would go through there and we would study these things out, and I would realize things like, God didn't harden Pharaoh's heart. God led Pharaoh to a place where he gave him a choice. Pharaoh chose to do what was wrong, and that hardened his heart. But God took partial responsibility because he allowed the choice to come. And as I realized that God was not responsible for that, we would just keep going through these stories over and over again in the Bible. Stories like the rich young ruler, stories that had always kind of bugged me. And I was seeing things about God that were really beautiful. Pictures of God that were humble, gentle, you know, he was just kind. And one day we got to the topic of hell. And they tried to tell this Baptist boy that there was no eternal burning hell. And I'm like, are you serious? I mean, you don't know this, but we major in hell in the Baptist church. I mean, we're fire and brimstone people. And so they're trying to tell me, and I'm like, go tell an Episcopalian or go tell a Pentecostal. Don't tell a Baptist there's no eternal burning hell. But as that truth began to dawn on my mind, as I realized that there were good, solid biblical evidences, you know, they took me to Malachi, the last chapter in Malachi, where it says that the wicked shall be dust under your feet. And I'm like, that cannot be if there's an eternal burning hell. You can't have people dust under your feet if they're burning forever. You know, truths like that began to dawn on my mind, and I began to see that there was good, solid biblical evidence for believing that God doesn't burn people forever. My mind was exploding. I was discovering somebody that I had grown up with and yet really never knew. This was bizarre. This is like you growing up all your life with somebody and then realizing one day that they are completely different than what you thought they were like. And my mind was exploding because I had this picture of God in my mind, and it was so radically different than the God I was falling in love with. And one by one, these I would say, call them a kind of dark glimpses of God, were being washed away, and they were being replaced with these beautiful pictures of God and his loving characters. You know, pictures like of the judgment. You know, I mean, you might not think the judgment's a beautiful thing, but it really is when you look at it and you see that God would step back and in the judgment say, hey, to the universe, here are the books of heaven. Did I do everything I possibly could? Was I fair? Now that's amazing when you think of the God of the universe stepping back and saying, okay, here's all the evidence. Was I fair? And I began to fall in love with this God that I was learning about. And no longer was it somebody saying, you ought to love God. You better love God. It's what you need to do. I was liking God. I liked hanging out with God. I was falling in love with him. And so one day, a pastor made an appeal to give your heart to the Lord. And I thought, well, you know, here I've had everything that I wanted, and my life was miserable. What if I give God a chance to be in control of my life? And that day I surrendered to the Lord and let him be in control. And that was the day that an adventure. So when you give your life to God, God does some very interesting things. There are certainly challenging times, but there are times when you see God work in some amazing ways. And shortly after I was baptized, I was still, you know, doing my graduate work up there in Oregon, and we had a problem. My family was going through a really rough time. My mom and dad were divorcing. My aunt was dying of cancer. And my family lives in the Midwest, and I was on the West Coast and really felt like I needed to be back there. But if you've ever been a grad student, you know that money is hard to find. And I just didn't have the money to get back to Illinois to be with my family in this very difficult time. And so I was learning to pray. And I got down on my knees and I just began to explain to God the problems in my life and how I needed to get back there. But money wasn't very, very easy to find. And shortly after I got up off my knees, I got a phone call. And I got a phone call from a headhunter. I don't know if you would know what a headhunter is, but in the technical world, headhunters are people that are always out looking for possible people to work at companies. And so they would, you know, hire you away from one company to work at another company. And this particular headhunter knew that I was getting close to finishing grad school, and he wanted to find me a job. Now, most aerospace and defense jobs are on the West Coast or on the East Coast. That's typically where you find aerospace, on the big guys anyways. But I asked him, I said, where's the interview at? And of all the places around the country it could be, where do you think it was? Chicago. Right where my family was. It was the only time I've ever had a defense aerospace interview in Chicago. And it came, to me it was like almost like God wrapping his arms around me and saying, I know what you're going through, and I'm going to provide. And he did. He did. They flew me at their own cost all the way from Oregon to Chicago, picked me up in a limousine, so God couldn't do enough, you know. And I was able to not only do the interview, but spend time with my family. And really good situation. So I was really blessed by that. So after I finished grad school, I took a job with a aerospace company down in Southern California called General Dynamics. and I worked in their missile systems there for a while. And while I was there, I saw God do one of the neatest things in my life that I've ever seen. But it didn't seem neat at the time. So I was working for this aerospace company, and taxes were eating me alive. I was a young engineer, scientist, and making good money, and the government was taking a big chunk of it. So I needed to do something. I needed to invest in some way. And the most obvious way was to buy a house. But I did not like that idea of buying a house. I grew up, and my dad owned several pieces of property, an apartment building, and we spent a lot of time working on houses. So I knew houses were a lot of work. So I was really reluctant to invest in real estate. But I began praying about it, and really felt impressed that the Lord was saying, you know, you should invest in housing. So I bought this house up in the Victor Valley area, and actually Hesperia, but bought this house, and unknown to me, I bought it at the peak of the California market. In other words, shortly after that, after I had purchased the house, which I really felt impressed, God was saying, I want you to buy this house. But shortly after I bought the house, the market just fell apart. This was in the late 80s, early 90s, and it just fell. And so this house that I owned was now worth less than I paid for it and less than what I owed on it. So in order for me to even sell the house, I would have had to not only pay the bank, but I would have had to pay more than it was worth. You know, because I was upside down in the house, I would have had to pay the real estate agent. It was just a mess. And then on top of it, not too long after the market kind of bottomed out, the company, General Dynamics, decided that they were going to sell our division. Now, we were a large division, and I think we had several thousand people that worked at our division, and they decided they were going to sell this division. Now I'm like, great, I'm upside down in my house, I owe more than it's worth, I would have to pay somebody to take it, I'd have to pay the real estate agent, and I'm losing my house, or I'm losing my job because the company is getting rid of this division. And I was like, Lord, what in the world's going on? You told me to buy this house, now I'm going to lose my job, and I'm upside down in the house. And, well, as you can imagine, as the days rolled on and the rumors just spread around the company, people were leaving left and right, people were abandoning ship because they knew that they were going to get rid of this division of General Dynamics. Well, I am just pleading with God, you know, God, what is going on? Why are you letting this happen to me in my life? And I'm really praying. And it seems, I don't know if you've ever gone through a time when it seems like God is silent. You pray and nothing happens. So I really prayed about it, and it just seemed like nothing was happening. God was silent. And I don't know if you've ever had times like that in your life when it just seems like God is quiet. But I've learned that sometimes when God is quiet, that's when he is doing some of his greatest work. Because in the background, I didn't know this, but Hughes, the company that I used to work with, had entered into negotiations with General Dynamics to purchase that division that the General Dynamics had decided to put on sale. Now, when Hughes did that, they decided to combine my old division that I worked for with this new division that I was working for. And not only that, but my old group with my new group and my old department with my new department. And my old department, who knew me, found out that I was working at Hughes in this department, or General Dynamics in this new department. And they called me and they said, John, we're forming a new company. We're getting rid of this old one here that you used to work with. We're getting rid of the one that you currently work with. And we're forming a new company. And we're going to make a new company in Arizona. And we want you to go with us. And John, if you'll go with us, we will give you not only your normal salary, but we will give you a $30,000 move package. $30,000 on top of everything. That was very sweet. And when they found out that I was upside down in the house and that I actually owed more on it than it was worth, They said, no, we'll make that $40,000. And so it was, again, God just confirming, you know, I'm going to take care of you. I will take care of you. And all of a sudden I had not only my normal salary and a new job in a new place where I was really liked what I was doing, but a $40,000 move package. And I was, through that, I was able to not only, you know, take care of the house and being upside down, but there's much more than that. I lived rent free for like a year and I paid off all my student loans. I was completely out of debt. And so in this experience where it seemed like, you know, God was just acting crazy and, you know, he told me to buy this house and now all this stuff is going wrong. It was really one of the best experiences of my life because I can look back on it and I can see how God was working all things together for good. So we were building systems for Blue Cross Blue Shield that actually read. So they were intelligent systems that would scan in a form and then extract the information from the form using some artificial intelligence and image processing. Really cool system. Anyways, over the years, something began to kind of build inside of me. I was really enjoying my work. We had some of the latest and greatest equipment to work with. But there was this sense of, I think is this just a sense of dissatisfaction, like. But let me explain. One year we as in a group of engineers and scientists spent $1 million, just a small group of engineers and scientists, we spent $1 million of your tax dollars on building this one system, and the election had happened and a new president came in and we took the whole system and we set it on a shelf. And I was like, we just took $1 million and put it on a shelf. And it made me begin to kind of think a little bit, is this what you want to do for the rest of your life? I mean, it was great work, it was fun, the money was great, but I was hoping for something where you made a little more impact in this world, made a little bit more of a difference. And so after working for Hughes for a year or two, I got approached by an academy up in the Oregon area called Laurelwood Academy. And Laurelwood asked if I would be interested in coming in teaching for them at their academy. And my initially, when I had first talked to him, I had actually talked to him a year before that, and I thought, no, I wouldn't be interested in teaching. That was not my thing. I didn't enjoy teaching. I had grown up in the public school system. We had like 2,000 students in our high school, and I had no desire to go back to a high school setting. But the more I talked with these guys, and the more I started to dialogue and to visit with them, the more I thought, well, maybe there's something here. And that began this huge struggle in my life because it was like, how can I leave this? I mean, I was doing things that I really enjoyed. I had a neat ministry. I was working on a book at the time on Daniel, the book of Daniel, a manuscript. And yet I felt this kind of pull in my life to maybe get involved with working with students and kids. And I kept struggling with this, and I kept going back and forth, and I was like, should I do this? Should I not do this? I mean, it was almost like playing ping pong with yourself. Can you imagine, like, hitting the ball and then trying to run to the other side of the table and hit it again and then run to the other? I felt like I was playing mental ping pong, just weighing the, you know, reasons why and why not. And finally, I called the school again, and I said to them, I said, I really need to come up. I had seen them once before, but I said, I think I need to come up again. And it had been 2 years later or a year and a half later. And I said, I need to come up and see the school again. And so they said, come. And so I booked a ticket, and it was so quick. I mean, it was just like, you know, I called them. They said, well, school's only on this week. Can you come up this weekend for graduation? And I'm like, I think so. And so I just, you know, just moved things really quickly, got a couple days off, and grabbed the flight, and I flew from Tucson to Arizona. I didn't even have time to go to the bank. I was planning on going in Arizona to the teller. There's a little ATM there, and I was going to get some money to just tide me over until I got to back home. Well, when I went to the ATM machine in Phoenix to pick up the money, it ate my card. it just ate my whole card, and I was like, oh no, I've got like $5 in my wallet to live on for 5 days. And I was like, great, you know, how am I gonna survive up there with $5 for these 5 days? Well, God is amazing. When I got up there, I didn't spend a thing. I mean, even when we got off the plane and the principal who picked me up said, hey, let's go get something to eat. I'm like, no, let's not. I only have $5. I didn't say that to him, but I was kind of thinking that in my heart. But he went to a really cheap restaurant, I thought, well, and he said, I'll buy. And so he paid. And for the rest of the weekend, God provided. In fact, I think I came back with more money than I left with. So after that weekend, I just really felt convicted. There were a number of things that happened through the weekend that just led me to feel like this is really where God wanted me. For instance, one of the things that happened was there was a student, he turned out to be the valedictorian, I didn't know this. But while I was visiting, I just happened to be talking to him one night. We talked for a little bit, and I was just talking to him about what his plans were. Well, on that weekend when graduation was happening, he got up and he was speaking, and he spoke about the impact that I had made on his life. And it really touched me. I thought, man, I only talked to him for a half hour. I only talked to him for maybe a half hour, and I made a difference in his life. Something God used me in some way to touch and help him. And I felt more and more like this is the way God wants me to go. He wants me to get involved with helping kids. So I went back and I told my boss, that I was leaving the company and that I was taking this other job. Well, in aerospace, you know, their question is, well, how much are they paying you at this new job? Because, you know, we could probably beat it. And you know, I didn't have the heart to tell them that I was going to be making like 1/5 of what I was making in the aerospace industry. And that the reason I wasn't for the money. But you know, even then, God did some really neat things, because as I was leaving, you know, word spreads quickly, especially when somebody is leaving and they're not leaving for money reasons. So my boss's boss heard about it. And one day she cornered me, and she was a big, I mean, this was a very important woman in the company, and she was like a VP or a charge of a whole area, charge of the whole commercial section for Hughes. And she cornered me, and I barely knew her, you know, I was surprised she even talked to me. And she said to me, John, why are you leaving? And I began to explain to her, and you know, I mean, she's a secular lady, but I began to explain to her that I really felt like, you know, I wanted to do something where, you know, I was making a difference in lives, I think, and also that I was writing this book on Daniel and Revelation. And she looked at me and she said, and I was shocked, she said, I'm interested in Daniel and Revelation. Now, this is my boss's boss's boss. And I said, well, something like, can I share with you what I've been learning? And she said, like, yes. So one day in the lunchroom, I met with Carol, and we sat down and we opened my Bible, and I shared with her some of the things I was learning in Daniel and Revelation. And the lunchroom was right next to where everybody walked in and out. And I wish you could have saw the looks on the faces of my coworkers. And I'm sitting in there with this Bible open in the secular company, explaining Daniel and Revelation to my boss's boss's boss. Incredible, incredible story. So I took the job with Laurelwood, and I started teaching mainly math and science kind of classes, like physics and chemistry, you know, math, algebra 2, pre-calculus, things like that, algebra 1, geometry. Got a chance to teach a lot of different classes and enjoyed it. When you give your heart to the Lord, God does some amazing things. There are some very difficult times, but there are some very encouraging times too. And God took me, and we did things that I don't think I would have ever done had it not been the adventure that God led me on. I don't think I would ever try to write a book. I don't think I would have ever visited all the countries and been involved with this humanitarian and evangelistic work like I've done. We've seen some amazing things. Been in Brazil, Jamaica, Romania, Ireland, England, Scotland, just all over, all kinds of neat places, and had the opportunity to see God use us to help people that were hurting, and that was a real privilege. But I think one of my highest joys is when I am in a classroom and I'm doing a worship, and something God shares with me that I share with the class or share with the worship touches somebody's life, and you see the hurt from the past kind of healing, the darkness kind of lifting, and light just kind of coming into their hearts. It is so beautiful to see that moment when their heart is really touched and God lifts the darkness and brings in hope. I really love that. It's just one of my highest joys, especially when I see God do that in a kid's life. Really, really enjoy that. So I taught for 16 years at Laurelwood, and then been teaching for about 5.5 years here at Weimar, both at the academy and the college. And through those years, we've had some really interesting experiences. I remember one year on a mission trip we did to New York after the Twin Towers had been destroyed. And the Adventist Church and ASI had decided they wanted to go to New York and to try to help, just to help console people in the midst of such devastation. And so they had set up a whole team to do Bible work in Manhattan and Brooklyn. And I had taken a group of students and staff from our school to go out there and to try to help, do what we could to help people who in their minds and hearts were probably going, why? Why does stuff like this happen in this world? So we had gone out there, and I was happy to take the group out there, but I was a little bit concerned because part of what their work was, they went door to door doing outreach, and I thought, I don't do stuff like that. I don't go to the doors of people I don't know and just start talking to them. I mean, it's just, I'm shy in that way. I feel very awkward. But we were going out there, and I felt God was leading us to go out there, and I'm kind of like, well, God, why am I going? Why am I doing this? Because I don't do this kind of stuff. I don't go to people's door that I don't know. And especially in a big city, because if you've ever been to a big city, there are two doors. You go through the first door, which is open, and you get to the mailboxes, and the second door is locked. And so you're not going anywhere. So anyways, we ended up in New York, and sure enough, they put me in the van. They said, you're going out with us. I was like, I don't know about this. So they put us on the street, and they assigned me to this Bible worker. This young Bible worker was probably about 19 years old. And she said, well, let's go. And I'm like, okay. So sure enough, we went to this first building. And we got to the building. And we went through the first door, and just as I suspected, the second door was locked. And I was kind of like, I told you so. God, I told you so. I mean, you're not going to get into places like this. Well, she turns to me and she says, let's pray. And I was probably thinking, I was so nervous. I probably wanted something, a prayer like this. Please let the rapture be true so that nobody's home so I don't have to do this. Or please save me because I don't want to do this. Deliver me from this stuff. But she says, let's pray. So she prays, and then she finishes praying. I kid you not. When she finishes praying, we looked through the door, and somebody was coming out. And as he was coming out, he opened the door and he let us in. And we went from door to door through that entire building, seeking people that were just basically looking for answers to the questions in their mind, why would God let something like this happen? And we got a number of people that were actually interested. I was amazed. There were people that really wanted to talk about the Bible. Well, we finished that building, and it was a big apartment building, and we went to the next one. And again, we got to the first door, and the second door was locked again. And it was kind of like, yeah? And she looks at me and she says, let's pray. And I reluctantly bowed my head again, and she prayed, and I kid you not, we opened our eyes. We had pressed no buttons, we had knocked, not at all, but when we opened our eyes, I could look through the second door, because it was a glass door, I could look through that second door and I could see all the way down the hallway. Well, at the end of the hallway, a door opened up. And a small child walked out of that door, walked all the way down the hallway, and opened the door for us and let us in. And my mind was just kind of like, what? It was as if God was saying, look, John, if you will just go forward, if you will just do what I told you to do, I will open the doors and make a way for you to do it, even when it seems impossible. We had a great time. Our students had a great time. Our staff had a great time. We came back on fire to do evangelism for God. And I had no idea how important that experience would be to me with that young Bible worker. Her name was Rebecca Fox. But that would be the catalyst for what God was about to do, because I saw how excited our students were about serving God after that. And I thought to myself, wow, wouldn't it be neat if somehow we could replicate that experience back here in Oregon? If somehow we could have Bible workers taking our own students out, training them how to do Bible studies, and actually getting out in the field and meeting people that were hurting and needed help. People that were struggling and wanted to know that God really cared for them. And so I began feeling more and more convicted that God did want to do that, that He did want to replicate that back here in Oregon at the time, on the West Coast. And so I began praying about it and sharing my conviction that God wanted. So when I came back from New York, I really had this desire to try to replicate what we saw there in Oregon, because it had made such a difference in our students' life and my own life. And the more I prayed about it, the more I was convicted that God wanted us to start a group of Bible workers in Oregon, going with our students out into the community and trying to reach out to people in the community. Well, that was the beginning of a really difficult time in my life, because it seemed like that although God wanted it, not everybody else wanted it. I was amazed. People who I really trusted told me, John, how are you going to do this? How in the world are you going to, on your salary, and we didn't make much, going to pay Bible workers, fund their gas money, fund their vehicles, fund their housing, and get out there? People that were in high positions in evangelism told me, you can't do this. You do not have the training. You do not have the ability to do it. And yet God was laying this burden on my heart to do it. And I just couldn't get away from the impression that God was saying, you need to do this. And so I, probably with faulty steps, stepped out and tried to do it. I started approaching the school and I said, hey, you know, God is laying a burden on my heart to do this, to hire Bible workers, to go out with our students and actually work with them in the field to do evangelism and to train them to do evangelism and to win people to Jesus at the same time. Well, as I shared the vision that the Lord was giving me with others, the school said, well, we're interested. We'll help. We'll provide housing. They can live in the dormitories. Then I approached our local church, and our local church board said to us, you know, John, we want to help too. We want to get involved. We'll fund one of the Bible workers' salaries. And then I approached, that was the church board, then I approached the church family, and I said, here's my vision. And they started making pledges, and they said, we will, in essence, support you in helping to reach people in our community. And we're going to fund one Bible worker's salary. Incredible things started happening. This one man came to me, he said, John, I sold my baby donkey because I felt impressed that God wanted me to do something to reach people in the community. people would come up to me. I remember, yeah, just over and over, people would just give me money to try to help. Well, so this impossible situation where we didn't have the funds, we didn't have the housing, we didn't have the vehicles, within about 6 months, we had 4 to 5 Bible workers that we had hired and were at on our location, on our campus, working with our students, going door to door in the community, giving Bible studies, doing evangelistic meetings. And God always provided. We ran that ministry, by the way, the name of the ministry was Pacific Northwest Center for Evangelism. We ran PNCE for 10 years. And we actually had times where we were up to about 10 Bible workers that were going out in the community. Other times when it wasn't so large. But for 10 years, God always provided. And that was amazing to me. It was amazing to me. I didn't have that kind of money. I didn't have the money to support one Bible worker, much less 10. But for 10 years, God provided every year, whether it was a few Bible workers or up to 10, He provided the money to go out and actually do help people in various ways. Sometimes it was evangelism. Sometimes it was just helping people with their physical needs. And we ran that ministry for 10 years. We saw God do some amazing, amazing things as we did, Bible work and evangelistic meetings in the community and tried to help people. Saw a number of people that took their stand for Jesus or decided to be baptized and came to know the Lord. So about 6 years ago, the school that I was working with, Laurelwood, decided that it was going to close its doors. There were a number of things that were going on in the institution, and it was a very disheartening time. I mean, I had worked for Laurelwood for 16 years and really come to kind of call it home. And good friends there, and one of the good friends there was the president of Laurelwood was Steve Hinton. And when they had decided to shut it down, Steve and I had talked, and we had decided that we would try to keep it open as a day school, that we would keep going just as a day school, just a few students, him and I, maybe teaching. But Randy, the principal at the time, he was kind enough, he had put out word to other institutes, just letting them know that Laurel was shutting down and that all these teachers were available if anybody needed any teachers. And so he was trying to help us to find new jobs. Well, I had gotten a call from Mr. Chad and at Wheatmar Academy, and he had told me, he said, we'd like to talk to you about the possibility of teaching at Wheatmar. And so we talked for a while, had a really good conversation. Love Chad, he's a great guy. And as we were talking, and I told him, I said, well, I got to be honest with you, Chad. I mean, our goal is right now that we want to keep the school open. We're going to try to keep it open as a day school. And the students and I are praying that God will do something amazing and help this to stay open as a day school. And so Chad and I talked for a while, and then we hung up the phone. Well, about a month or two later, I got this phone call that Chad was on his way up to Laurelwood, and he wanted to meet with me and interview with me.
So I get asked to go up to a school up in Oregon and to talk, do a worship talk, and it's about 5 or 6 hours away. And anyway, I'm driving up there, and I had a lot going on, thinking, why, Lord, am I driving so far up north? I'd rather be here at work. And I'm just kind of bummed out about it. Anyway, I go up there, have the worship talk, meet everybody, and I run into this guy. His name's John Peacock.
And I thought, oh no. I really blew it. I somehow gave Chad the impression that I was interested in coming to Wheatmar, and he's coming all this way, and I'm planning on keeping Laurelwood open, and I felt really bad.
And he's teaching math and science classes, and it's fair to say that, at least from my part, the bromance was right away. When I met him, and the way that he interacted with the kids, and he was just a godly man who just loved teaching, and you could just tell there was something different about this guy. Well, the school that I went to visit was in the process of closing, so I didn't know if, you know, what he was going to be doing next year. So I told him, I said, hey, look, I don't know what your future plans are, but we would love for you to come work at Weimar Academy, because we needed a math teacher.
So I called him very quickly, and I'm like, you know, I'm sorry, I don't know what happened, but, you know, we're trying to keep Laurelwood open, and we chatted, and he was like, it's all right, I'd still like to meet with you. And so we met, and I gave him a tour of Laurelwood and told him a little bit about, you know, what we were doing there and some of the stuff, and just had a really good conversation with him.
So he's like, well, you know, I'm trying to work things out to try and help these kids. I mean, what's going to happen to these kids, you know, if we close the school and if I leave? And, you know, I really feel called to stay and help them, which made me, of course, like the guy even more. So I came back to Weimar Academy, and they said, how was your trip? I said, oh, it was super long. However, I met this amazing guy, and, oh, he would be so cool. It would be so cool if he could join our team.
But still thinking in the back of my mind that, you know, I'm going to stay here and I'm going to be a teacher. We're going to, you know, keep Laurelwood open, keep it going as a day school. Well, in about June of that year, it became clear and apparent that the donors, who were a big part of making this Laurelwood work, because Laurelwood was a self-supporting school, they were fatigued and it was not going to happen. Laurelwood was closing. And I thought, great, what now? What now? Because I had been seeking first the kingdom of God. I had been thinking about my students and trying to make sure that, you know, we did whatever we could for them and for what was best for, and I was like, what do I do now? I mean, they hired teachers in February, it's June. And so I called Mr. Chad and I, you know, kind of reluctantly said, by any chance, or maybe fearfully said, by any chance, are you still looking for a teacher? And he said, hang on a second, let me call you back.
And so we prayed about it, and I think, I can't remember the time frame, but a few weeks later, John calls me and he says, hey, you know, if you're still interested, I think that I might be interested in moving down to California to work with your team. And I'm like, praise the Lord, of course I'm interested, you know. So he came down and
he called me back in a few minutes and he said, yes. Well, what I didn't know was this whole time there had been a couple, and the gentleman in the family was the math teacher, the current math teacher at Weimar, and they were longing to get involved with mission work. They wanted to go to the mission field. And they told Chad, we really want to go to the mission field, you know, search for another teacher, but if you cannot find anybody, we'll stay. And that very day, the day that I called Chad, that day before, Chad had told them, I can't find anybody. Can you stay? And they said they would. And so this whole time, God had been holding that position open for me. And Chad simply called them and said, are you still interested? And they were like, yes. And Chad was like, well, then I think I've got somebody that might be interested in coming and taking your place. And God had preserved that position. He had made it and kept it open for me. Again, his amazing providence is in life. Good afternoon. I'd like to talk to you today a little bit more about triangles. One of the challenges we face when we deal with triangles is that if the triangle is not a right triangle, it's difficult to find the sides. So we resort to another formula called the law of cosines.
To say that he fit right in was an understatement. He just, you know, just connected so well with staff and students. And he has such a heart for people. He wants them to grow closer to Christ. And that's what I really, truly love about him. He's my brother, and I'm so glad that we have gotten to work together.
So in 2011, I started working for Weimar Academy. And I loved it. I work with some great people. It was really, in many ways, it was a dream team of teachers and staff, people that were very dedicated to God. They loved God, and they really wanted to make God look beautiful in the eyes of kids and the public. And so I had the privilege of working many years with Chad and Mike and Margaret, Siwa, Lorraine, many other really neat people through the years.
John is my brother in Christ, and one thing that I've always appreciated about him is he's selfless. He's always looking to help other people. He's always looking to put others before himself, and that's something that I really admire about him and desire for myself. One of the things that those of you that know John, whenever he comes over to visit, he brings a gift, and for me, he always brings Martinelli's, fake champagne. And I just know if John's coming over for dinner or for a visit, he's got a bottle with him, and I'll always every time I look at Martinelli's, I think of John Peacock. And I mean, what a great thing to be associated with a guy that's always bearing gifts. And I just really appreciate that. And as a co-worker, as working together here at the Academy, one thing that I just love about him is that he always starts his math classes out with worship.
Going to work, make a difference. Amen. When you're thinking about your projects for this class or for proof, think about how you could use something to make a difference in the world.
Right. And he's just focused on Christ. And the young people, you know, they're learning from a highly competent man in the field, but what they remember is his love and devotion for Christ and how he always started his classes out with worship. And that's powerful. I mean, you don't typically hear that about a math teacher, but that's John Peacock. Just a fantastic guy.
And really, really enjoyed it. About a year after I started working at the Academy, the college tapped me on the shoulders. Since I have a master's in physics and some doctoral work in physics, they said, could you teach our physics class for us at the college? And so I started teaching physics, and then before I knew it, I was teaching pre-calculus over here and started enjoying working with some of the staff over here. Some really neat things going on at the college side too, and that's been a blessing too for us.
I can still kind of remember my first time meeting Mr. Peacock, and it was actually in pre-calculus class my sophomore year. And the first thing I noticed when I went to his class was that really stuck out to me were actually his devotionals. I thought his devotionals were like the most powerful thing ever, and they just, every single day we come into class, we know that we're going to receive a blessing when we come in there. I still remember Lance and I, we would joke around that like we would have spiritual heartburn because like it was so powerful. So that's just something I can remember. My first impression was this man has really awesome devotionals. And all the time I think of Mr. Peacock, you know, I always think of meekness. You know, he's a rather quiet guy, but at the same time, you know, he's willing to converse and he's willing to help you out. He wants you to achieve the goal you want to achieve, and he's more than willing to be self-sacrificing in that, whether it be his time or, you know, just his knowledge and whatnot. So I really see meekness in Mr. Peacock. Right now, I'm actually currently taking physics with Mr. Peacock. It's a massive class of just Lance and I. But honestly, when I went into physics class, I thought to myself, this is probably going to be the hardest class I'm going to have to take in college. And I was right. It actually is a very difficult class. But I have to say, Mr. Peacock, and you know, just physics in general, is just a very enjoyable subject. I'm not saying it's easy, because you know, when I'm working on the problems and you know, trying to do the math and everything like that, it's pretty difficult, and you know, I can mess up, and I can sometimes I don't understand things, but in general, with all these concepts, with all these theorems, with all these different things that we're learning in physics, it's actually very interesting to me. It's very intriguing, and there would be days that as we're talking about physics and Mr. Peacock is lecturing us, that I would be like mind blown. I'd be like, are you serious? So according to this theorem, this is going to happen if that happens, and it just completely blows your mind, and you want to look at the world outside you differently and see where you can see that theorem or that law, you know, taking place. And like, physics just really just blows your mind. But it's definitely a class that's hard, but I'm grateful for it. But there's many different reasons why I appreciate Mr. Peacock. One reason is that he's a very raw guy. And I remember doing kind of bad, actually pretty bad, for one of my tests in pre-calculus. And you know, the normal teacher would kind of go up to you and kind of rebuke you and ask you that, why aren't you doing so good in this? What happened? But I still remember Mr. Peacock called me aside to his office, and I was ready for a lecture, but he simply asked me, what's going on in your life? And at that moment in my life, there was actually a very heavy burden that I was carrying. He was just someone that helped me to lead me back to the cross, to drop that burden down. And I'm forever grateful for that. And I just hope and pray that more teachers would do that. Because, you know, students, more than they need a grade, they actually need mentorship. So that is something I truly and greatly appreciate about Mr. Peacock. And Mr. Peacock, if you ever watch this video, I just want to say thank you for being a blessing in my life.
When my foes surround me, set me high above.
If I could leave you with two things, I think they would be this. Some of you guys have been through some really difficult times, or maybe going through some difficult times, and I would want you to know that God cares and He wants to help. That, you know, there is a God in heaven, and He really cares about what you're going through, and He really wants to do something to help you as you're going through it. The second thing I would like to leave you with is this thought. You know, in my life, religion always seemed like it was something you were supposed to do. You know, God was something you ought to do, or you better do, or else, or something like that. And I'd like to encourage you never to be satisfied with that. Never be satisfied with a religion that is simply, you know, obligatory or simply guilt or fear-based. Because there's something so much greater. There's something so much more beautiful than that. And that's why I would really want to encourage you that don't be satisfied with that. Don't sing love songs and never fall in love. Don't be satisfied with a religion where you just know that you're supposed to, but you never fall in love with God. And I'd really encourage you to just get down on your knees and plead with God until He gives you that experience where you truly fall in love with Him, where you really discover that He really is good, that He really is somebody that you would like to just know and hang around with. Don't be satisfied with anything less than pure love.
Să-ți cântăm neîncetat, căci Tu ne-ai